Black holes don't exactly ham it up for the camera. Since light cannot escape from these massive objects, they are difficult to spot, let alone photograph. But despite the immense challenges of a black hole photo shoot, the Event Horizon Telescope collaboration managed to snap the first picture of a black hole in history using a virtual Earth-sized telescope. The international team aims to unravel the mysteries of supermassive black holes, including the one lurking at the center of our own galaxy. It's a real pleasure to welcome Ziri Younsi, an astrophysicist and UKRI Stephen Hawking Fellow at University College London's Mullard Space Science Laboratory. And he's also a member of the Event Horizon Telescope Collaboration. Thank you so much for talking to us today.
No, it's my pleasure, Becky. Thanks for having me on.
Well, this telescope is so fascinating, both in terms of the really mind-boggling targets that it is taking pictures of, black holes, but also just in terms of its sheer scale. So I just wanted to start by asking you, what is the telescope and how does it work?
It's actually a very interesting question because it isn't just one telescope. It's actually a network of telescopes spread all across the world. And for this famous image that we first saw in April 2019, that was actually the combined efforts of 8 radio telescopes spread all around the world, including even in the South Pole. And so it's 8 telescopes that are connected together through a very special technique because obviously you're recording that information at each telescope, but the radiation that comes from the black hole, which I'm sure we'll talk about a little bit later in more detail, arrives at slightly different times. So we have to use a very special technique called interferometry to connect, to synchronize these telescopes. And so we record the data of all of these different telescopes simultaneously, and it's all stored on hard disks, and then it's all brought together at the very end to put the data together synthetically. So it's not one telescope, it's actually a big network.
And it's an Earth scale network. Does that make it like the biggest interferometer that exists right now?
Yes, that's absolutely correct. It's the biggest interferometer that exists right now, and it works at radio wavelengths. And it is precisely because of this scale, because it's Earth-sized, that we can achieve the resolutions that we need to resolve a black hole. Because even though these supermassive black holes, like in the one in M87, in the galaxy Messier 87, rather, that we saw, it's an enormous black hole, but it's actually still very, very, very far away. And so its angular size on the sky is absolutely minuscule. So it's an unprecedented technological feat, really, to be able to achieve the kind of resolutions that we achieved as a collaboration to resolve it in the first place.
And why was Messier 87 the target? You know, there's black holes at the center of all these galaxies. What made this one the photogenic target for this?
Right, that's a great question. And actually, it's actually a perfectly legitimate question too. Why do we focus on that black hole? Well, actually, the one we really want is in the galactic center. It's our own supermassive black hole, very special place in astronomers' hearts, and we've been studying it for a very long time. But that's quite a difficult one to image. Messier 87 is one of the biggest black holes in the universe. It's absolutely enormous. It weighs in at over 6.5 billion times the mass of our sun. So it's up there. It's in the top few of black supermassive black holes that we know. And because of its enormous size, and relatively, it's quite close to us. What that means is that if you look at the actual size of this thing compared to its distance, its angular size, is just within the limits of us being able to resolve it with the EHT, the Event Horizon Telescope.
Well, it's funny to hear like the easiest black hole to image when it's actually like
still pretty tough.
They're notoriously very difficult to see because of course they don't emit light. Light can't escape them. So could you talk a little bit about the challenges of that and the kind of resolution that this telescope needs to see something that's not only 55 million light years away, but also is a black hole?
As you said, like it's very difficult to see because you can't directly see a black hole. It has an event horizon. And so anything which crosses that event horizon, even light itself, will be forever trapped. And light which strays very close to the black hole can actually orbit the black hole multiple times in spherical orbits. So it's kind of like if you were near a black hole, very close to a black hole's event horizon, you would see multiple images of the back of your own head because light which bounces off your head would orbit multiple times before it reaches you. And each one would be one orbit, two orbits, and so on. So you see very weird things. Light doesn't behave as it does here on Earth and travel in straight lines. So even your perception of what you see would be totally warped. So there's a few ways that we use to explain this when we give like public talks. And I like, my two favorites actually are, the first one is it's like trying to resolve an orange on the surface of the moon with your naked eye. Or another would be holding your finger out in front of you and being able to see individual atoms in your own finger. So that's the scale of the resolving power of the EHT. So, and even now, we can just about resolve the size of the event horizon itself. So we're not yet on scales smaller than that. And in time we will be, but this is just the first step.
That is just a phenomenal achievement. And thinking about looking at the atoms in my hand, it's just really puts it into perspective. So, you know, when this image did come out in 2019, we being space nerds here at the show, of course, loved it. But I was actually really happy to see the public. I mean, people who had never really thought about black holes. I saw them posting on Twitter and social media. It really was this big public splash and people were really engaged with it. And I think it was a great way to show that, show something visual about a black hole that brought in a whole new audience of space lovers. So what was that like for you as a member of the collaboration to see how excited people were about this image?
Oh, it was amazing. And I have to say, it was not expected. It was completely unanticipated, actually, at least on my part. We didn't expect that image would resonate with people so strongly. And okay, so but my own background is I've been working on these kind of images for years, ever since I was a graduate student. And so to me, it wasn't a surprise to see the image in the sense that we just thought, oh, it kind of looks a lot like what the theoretical calculations predict. And oh, we have a cool picture now. And obviously, this is the picture that would be used and shared around the world. But we didn't expect it would be covered by so much media. There would be the positive, the coverage was phenomenal. And then secondly, didn't expect it to sort of touch people in quite human and almost sort of like existential ways, right? So like it's just quite an evocative image for a lot of people, ourselves included. And the response was amazing. So some people would see bagels or cosmic donuts and stuff like this. And then other people would see the eye of Sauron, So, and for some, and then for other people still, they would see it as this like beautiful, mysterious object. Others would see it as the edge of the gates of hell and all this kind of stuff.
It was wonderful to see. And, because black holes are often kind of more in the theory, in the mathematical calculation realm and stuff, to have that's something that's much more relatable. We should explain that it's not the eye of Sauron or anything such malevolent. What are we actually looking at? What's that ring and why is it brighter on the one side than the other?
That ring, we believe to actually be extremely hot gas or plasma it's circulating, it's orbiting around the black hole and it's gradually falling inwards. And that plasma is extremely hot and it's emitting a lot of radiation. And the reason why it's brighter in one part of the image, so more towards the bottom half, and dimmer in the top half, is to do with the fact that the black hole is actually spinning quite rapidly, we believe. And because it's spinning rapidly, part of it's approaching us. And then, of course, conversely, another part of it's receding away from us. So the part which is approaching us is actually brighter because it's Doppler boosted into our line of sight. A little bit like when you hear an ambulance come by and it's approaching, you hear it getting louder, right? But when it's moving away, the sound is stretched and it appears to sound a little bit quieter than it would be if it was stationary.
Along those lines, what can we learn from this line of study? And particularly black holes, obviously they're really interesting on their own merits, but what can they tell us broadly about the universe and how can the Event Horizon Telescope shed light on this kind of stuff?
Black holes have the strongest gravitational fields in the universe. So if you can start to understand more about what's going on about gravity in that regime, then you understand more about what space and time really mean. And you understand more about what it is to have cosmic expansion and where we come from. And so, it's really touches at the heart of basic human understanding of what governs the universe, because gravity really is the weakest force by many, many orders of magnitude compared to the three other fundamental forces. And yet it seems to be the force which dominates.
Absolutely. And it's interesting to me that, black holes being, these non-luminous, very mysterious objects, but actually illuminating so many different,
different parts
of science. Yeah, they are truly amazing laboratories. You know, speaking of giant observational projects like EHT, I read that you were also part of the LISA collaboration. This one is just mind-boggling to me, and I'd love if you could just talk a little bit about that that project and what it will eventually
Do. Yeah, so I joined the LISA, so this is the Laser Interferometer Space Antenna mission about two years ago, actually, when I moved back to the UK. But so what is LISA? It's a space-based gravitational wave observatory. But it's very special. So first of all, it isn't going to launch till at least the mid-2030s. So it's a way away still. What LISA will be able to do is extend the sensitivity such that you'll be able to look at supermassive black holes. And they're a lot more interesting, scientifically speaking, for various reasons. But understanding what's going on with binary supermassive black holes will tell us a lot more about the early universe. It will tell us a lot more about black hole physics itself. And it allows us to probe Einstein's theory in this really dynamical regime. And also, there's going to be a lot of stuff that we don't even expect to detect, that we can't anticipate. So this serendipitous science, which is really true science, we will find things, I'm sure, which we just don't anticipate. And that's really the exciting thing. And actually, what LISA will enable us to do is look at objects like neutron stars in our galactic center orbiting Sagittarius A star and use the precise timing properties and the waveforms that we detect to actually measure and probe space-time structure and to actually map space-time. And so instead of saying, right, we want to measure the mass or spin of a black hole, we can actually use this object, which is like a test mass, and it's very precisely known mass because neutron stars don't vary much in mass. And you can actually like almost perform cartography of space-time in principle. So you can really measure the geometrical structure of the space-time and unambiguously answer once and for all the questions about the mass, the spin, which theory of gravity is Einstein correct. So I think in the 2030s and beyond, we're getting into the realm of like really understanding gravity a lot more intimately.